how can we detect otherwise undetected victims of human trafficking? This is the University of the Netherlands.
Human trafficking. It's such a sad story to be telling you today, but it's an important one that I want to convey to you. Worldwide, at this stage, on every year that we know, 42 million men, women, boys and girls are being exploited. And that is, you probably think of human trafficking in the context of forced prostitution, the stereotype that we know the best. But modern slavery, as it's also become to known, is also something that happens in the context of restaurants, of transportation, of agriculture, horticulture, forced begging, something that you can see on the street, forced commission of crimes like pickpocketing or making people produce illegal drugs, for example. And it's a huge industry in terms of money, not something that we'd like to talk about, of course, but it now earns the 2014 estimation of it is that it is a $150 billion industry. Now, I can see how that is just a large number and how you wouldn't necessarily know what that would relate to. That is the combined revenue of four huge companies, Facebook, Starbucks, Disney, and Nike. So $150 billion is made every year by exploiting other people. Now, since it's such an enormous amount of money that is involved, it makes sense to look at it from a financial perspective. How can we follow the money on a crime like this? How can we perhaps detect victims in an unorthodox source of data, financial data? Right? Look at financial institutions and what type of information would be available to them. Now, before I start to talk about the ways in which we do this research and how we actually try to detect victims of human trafficking in bank data, I want to tell you that it's such a complex legal crime. Right? It's an immensely difficult crime. But if we want to clarify it and make it easier, it's important to know three things. First of all, what is required are actions. So the perpetrator has to do something like transport people, recruit them, house them somewhere. Those are the first category of things that need to be proven in court. A second element is the means that are being used. So you do these types of actions with certain types of means. Sometimes that's real force, physical force. Sometimes it's deception. Sometimes it's abusing someone's vulnerable position. And in addition to that, you require a purpose. It has to be done for a certain reason. And that reason is to make sure that you exploit someone in all these sectors that I've just mentioned. So in sexual exploitation, in labor exploitation, in criminal exploitation, or, and that's the saddest thing as well, we don't only talk about humans in whole, but also in part. And you've probably heard of organ trafficking as well. That is all part of the definition of human trafficking. Now, I want to talk about human trafficking globally, but let us look at a certain example here in the Netherlands so that you can also bring it home. In the Netherlands, we now assume that there might be some 6,500 victims of human trafficking. 6,500. So of the 42 million, as I told, globally, some 6,500 are here. Unfortunately, however, we seem to be able to detect fewer and fewer victims in the last few years. So now you can see this as a very prominent downward trend. At this stage, only a ninth of victims of human trafficking in the Netherlands are being discovered. And this is while the Netherlands is one of the best countries, if in terms of any ranking, it's one of the best countries in terms of all of its anti-human trafficking efforts. And still, we're only capable of finding only a ninth of victims. So of every one person that we do find, eight of them, we won't be able to find them. And not only this, also criminal investigations are getting worse. At this stage, we're seeing a downward trend of the number of criminal investigations that currently take place. If you want to look at it from the perspective of sexual exploitation, something that we know more of, some cases are brought to court. But on all of those other crimes, like labor exploitation and criminal exploitation, on average, there are only 23 cases brought to court per year. Of those 6,500, right? So at this stage, if you compare that to last year's 2008 number of cases, criminal cases that came before Dutch courts, those were 88,000. So 1.02% on human trafficking outside of the sex industry. It's such a small number of people. Now, of course, right, we want to do something about this. Netherlands being a good country, trying to do all of these efforts. So this is why we thought we need to do something different. If we only detect a ninth of victims, if we only have so few cases, so few criminal investigations, let's try and see if we can do something completely different and look at an unorthodox source of information, financial institutions information. So we created a consortium with four banks, some of them also operating internationally, five scientists and nine public agencies, trying to find a way so that we can look into bank data and actually detect those victims that now remain undetected in financial data and in contextual data that banks have as well. Now, of course, I'm afraid I can't tell you all of the work that we've done, because, of course, we don't want to alert human traffickers as to the ways that we're now being capable to find their victims. But I do want to tell you something about the ways in which we work so that you get a sense of the information that we shared amongst ourselves in the consortium. Now, for you to understand that, you need to know a little bit about the law. I won't go into much detail about the law, but you need to know a little bit. So what we try to do is have banks look at unusual transactions within all of their data and try and see if by looking at their unusual transactions in a different way, they could look at victims of human trafficking that to whom those unusual transactions concern or are related. Now, once a bank finds such unusual transactions, they have to report it to the Financial Intelligence Unit. The intelligence unit of the Financial Intelligence Unit, the FIU, is a little bit like the CIA, like an intelligence agency, but on financial matters only. So a bank reports it to a Financial Intelligence Unit, who will then look at those unusual transactions under state secrecy. They'll look whether those reported unusual transactions are also suspicious transactions, so perhaps relating to a certain crime, in this particular instance, hopefully relating to human trafficking. Now, once that has been determined by the Financial Intelligence Unit, it will be passed on as a suspicious transaction, potentially relating to human trafficking, to law enforcement. And then those criminal investigations can be opened. So this is the way in which we've structured our legal framework under which we operate. Now, I can see how you might think, how are those all of those separate agencies, how are they thinking about our privacy, right? I mean, these are our data. We don't want a bank to look into our data from that perspective. This is how we covered it legally. The bank will look at its own data without telling anyone else anything about your data. But if it's an unusual transaction pertaining to human trafficking, it will, under secrecy, refer to the Financial Intelligence Unit. Yet another time, that agency does its work without sharing information about anyone, to anyone, unless it's a suspicious transaction. So this is our way of making sure that we abide by the legal framework and that all privacy regulations are ensured. So to recap, what is it that we do? This is the best possible visual that I think we could make of this. Now, if you'd have human trafficking, we'd look at the banks and we go through transactions and you see certain patterns or interactions that help a bank to determine whether an unusual transaction has taken place. We do so for a query that we created all together, the entire consortium. Then when that query is run, something else needs to be done. And currently, although we speak a lot about big data in banks and automated work, that has to be done manually. So a data analyst that sees those most risky situations of unusual transactions looks into open sources, as you would do, just Google Map, a certain location, for example, and they have to look into transactions. How are those transactions monitored? Where do they end up? Where does a transaction go, for example? In addition to that, of course, you might want to know what types of results we actually had. Now, these are indicators that I will refer to later. This is, for example, if you try to pretend that you have run a regular business, let's say an agricultural company, but you don't want to give the person the real money that he or she earns, but you want to make sure that the legal pretend is fine, but in practice, you make sure that someone will never have that certain money on their bank account, right? You immediately withdraw it, you immediately have a person transfer it, you'll make sure that the person needs to withdraw it from the ATM. Now, this is one of the financial indicators that we used. In addition to that, a bank doesn't only have financial information, they also have information about customers. For example, do many people live at a certain home address? Because of course, if you're a human trafficker and you want to make sure that you can exploit people in a certain place, you make sure that you house them in a certain area, for example, in your own arranged living arrangement, and then you'll transport them, right? Because you control their movement. This is how we did that. Now, in addition to that, I can imagine that you want to know what types of results, right? From bank to FIU to law enforcement. We've been lucky enough, actually, to say that we've opened two criminal investigations on the basis of this research. So two criminal cases that otherwise might not even have happened. One of them was concerning victims that we didn't really know about, but there was some suspicion about the company involved. The other one was a criminal investigation into a completely new set of victims. So actually showing that we can detect victims that we otherwise might never have found. The other type of action is, of course, if you can't open a criminal investigation, other types of actions can be taken by law enforcement, like a surveillance action. So the labor inspectorate can go to a certain house and see if, for example, the people who are living there are actually living there under right conditions and aren't made to work and aren't made to be exploited. That was the other result that we've been able to achieve, thanks to only running the query and looking into all of the other elements on only 2% of the data of one bank. So imagine if we now start with four banks and if we actually open it up to all of their data. We hope that it will really achieve something. Now, in addition to that, of course, you need to think about what types of information are available in bank data. Now, this is one way to look at what all of the information is that can actually be in possession of a bank. I wanted to talk to you, of course, because many of you are students as well. So in terms of students, right, if human trafficking can occur as a domestic crime, but sometimes, of course, people are coming to the Netherlands from a different type of country, a source country. Now, these 24 students were actually finishing their agricultural degree. So in the home country, they were already following a university degree, and the only thing they needed to do was have this internship in the Netherlands to finish their agricultural studies. You can see them on the left. Those are the 24 students, right? Now, the 24 students were paid by those agricultural and horticultural companies, Dutch-based, and they were paid less than a minimum wage. Now, that could be allowed, of course, if you're studying and finishing your degree, but nonetheless, they were paid a little bit. Not only that, these 24 students all lived in the same building, the same home address. We know that from the bank data because all of their bank accounts were registered on the same address. Not only that, all those 24 students who were given a little bit of wage were actually made to withdraw, most likely, all of that money at the same address at almost the same time, a couple of months, right? So in terms of getting some money and immediately having to withdraw it, the money was gone. Not only that, perhaps those students weren't necessarily standing in a queue and all withdrawing the money at the same time. Maybe someone else did that, because actually they had all authorized someone else to have access to their bank account. Now, who might have been that person? The person who was also part of a recruitment agency, who not only sent money to the source country, but also received money from that source country. And in addition to that, and this is where it's starting to become a little bit stranger, also the companies were paying that recruitment agency. Now for what? And in addition to that, the 21st students also paid the recruitment agency for loans or per agreement, where it wasn't really sure what they were repaying. Now this is not to say that you know for sure that this is a human trafficking case. This is all of the information that is available at a bank that can now be transferred to the financial intelligence unit and hopefully, of course, will form the basis for a criminal investigation. And then all of these people have to be examined. But it will allow, of course, law enforcement to look into, now we're going to that home address of these 24 students, for example, and we want to know, what is your living arrangement? Did you authorize someone else on your bank account? Did you get your full salary? So that you can actually pose the right questions and make sure to actually be very informed about what happens. Now, in terms of what next, right? If this is what we can discern from finding victims that we otherwise might not have detected, follow the money, discern the structures, know what is behind, right? Which is all hidden. We might be able to think about new ways to look at information. And as a last sort of parting thought I wanted to give to you is, what would you be able to do as a consumer? Now, as much as I said at the very first introduction, right, that it would be good to know that all of this is happening around you, I really would like you to think about the products that you buy, the services that you use, right, to think about what might be happening to the people involved, because it's so important to all be eyes and ears. So this is one of the reasons why I wanted to say to you, is it possible to detect victims of human trafficking that we otherwise would not be able to detect? I think so. And please help us with doing so. Thank you.